Hello from ChemHelp ASAP. The E2 reaction has some stereochemical considerations. Let's talk about them. In this channel's video on the E2 reaction, the requirements for E2 are essentially a strong base, an alkyl halide, and a beta hydrogen. For most E2 reactions, that's about all you need to know. In some cases, however, we need to be aware of the relative orientation of the beta hydrogen and leaving group. On the screen, in the upper left, is an alkyl halide. I'm focusing on the bromine, not those fluorines. This is a six-membered ring, so I've also drawn it as a chair with both possible flips. Remember that these are in equilibrium with each other. If we treat this molecule with sodium hydroxide, a strong base, then we'd expect an E2 elimination. The restriction for a beta hydrogen and the leaving group is that they should ideally be anti to each other for an E2 reaction. In other words, the dihedral angle between the halide and the beta hydrogen should be 180 degrees. For the chair on the left, we have the bromine, it's axial down, and a beta hydrogen, which is axial up, and they have an anti-relationship. If this were to react with sodium hydroxide, we would expect to get the E2 elimination. In fact, we get the Saitsev product. I'm going to flatten this out when I draw the product, but based on our starter material, in the upper left, we would expect this structure. So the chair on the left will work for the E2. In the other chair, however, neither beta hydrogen is anti-relative to our carbon-bromine bond. Neither of those are anti. Therefore, the E2 would be less favorable for this chair on the right. So the elimination likely won't occur from this chair. This chair on the right will flip to the chair on the left, and then the E2 will occur. Okay, now let's change the structure a little bit. Let's replace one of our beta hydrogens with a methyl group. We have two possible structures. They're both in the bottom left. I've drawn them as flat structures. On the upper structure, I replace the H that's down with the methyl. And in the bottom of structure, I put in place of the hydrogen that's up, I put in a methyl. So let's see what happens. Will this impact the E2 reaction? And of course it will, yes. So let's go back to our reactive chair conformation. The one here in the middle top of the screen. If the down hydrogen is replaced with a CH3, then we'll still have an anti-beta hydrogen, the one that's axial up. With the methyl replacement, we'd expect the reaction to still occur. So if we did that reaction, that E2, so we'll treat this with sodium hydroxide. Now we have a methyl down here. We get nearly the same product. We just now have a CH3 there. We get the Saitsev product. So this reaction should work. If the up hydrogen, axial up, this one right here, were to be replaced with a methyl, then we would no longer have an anti-beta hydrogen. So what happens? Well, since the preferred Saitsev product is no longer easily accessible, the base may look for something else to do. Maybe the base will look to this carbon, the CH3, and actually make the Hoffman product instead. So it's harder to predict what will happen since the favorable reaction is no longer a possibility, but we may get actually the Hoffman product, which would be this molecule instead. And I'll put a question mark on there because it's harder to predict exactly what will happen. So E2 reactions are more favorable if the beta hydrogen and leaving group can have an anti-relationship. The E2 reaction is often called an anti-elimination, which is the title we have at the top of the screen. A common way to demonstrate this anti-preference is to show eliminations on cyclohexane rings, in which the beta hydrogen and leaving group are both in axial positions to set up the anti-relationship.